Good afternoon. Today we are going to close our work related to Open Systems Project, which was about the experience of self-organized art initiatives in Russia in the last 15 years. So we would like to discuss several things today on Saturday with the participants of self-organized art initiatives, and they're going to be about the theory and practices of such initiatives. So the first part of our meeting is going to be about practical things. And we're going to have Kirill Preobrazhensky. He represents Cheremushki Gallery, it's an apartments gallery. Then Tatiana Volkova, who represents ZHIR Gallery. She is one of the participants of a media udar platform, and she is one of the curators. So I would like to invite our panelists to come here up front. I guess Kirill is not here actually, so we are waiting for him. Then Evgenia Abramova is going to join us a little bit later. She's on her way here. She's a specialist in social issues of culture, and she calls herself a cultural worker. She also works here at the Garage Museum for Contemporary Art. Then Kirill Zatsepin, she represents the Gallery of One Artwork and Lyot Gallery from Samara. Then Maxim Ilyukhin, he is also a very experienced worker. He worked for ABC Gallery at Art Strelka, and then the gallery office in Art Play. Then a very interesting project called Universam. Then Lizaveta Matveeva, an independent curator and art critic, who participated in our project from the very beginning because she was a member of the working group. Unfortunately, Anastasia Ryabova won't be able to join us today, but we should probably start our conversation right now. And also we have Yelena Ishenko, who is a member of the working and research group here at Garage. This is a final discussion, and it's going to consist of two parts, practices and theory. So we are going to explore how the independent initiatives exist, what kind of problems or challenges they encounter, how they overcome those challenges. And I guess this is a most important session for me, really, because this is an attempt to share our experience with others, with new and young people, and to hand it over to them. And then we'll, in the second part, we're going to discuss why all these initiatives exist and what they serve. So I would like to start with the question of independence. Whether these sites, whether these platforms are really independent, and I mean financial, political, ideological independence. We have a video, you probably have seen it all, and Masha Gutko is one of the organizers of Red Square Gallery, which has already shut down. So she says that this independence is not exactly real independence, because some people had to work for things they didn't really care for, because they had to provide funds for the gallery's existence. Some people had to work as designers, some people had to sell their works via different institutions, so they had to interact with certain organizations. So Is the independence possible then? Hello? Let me start as one of the participants and as one of the panelists here. I'm here for the third time now, so it's my third meeting. So it's interesting for me to participate in this project. So since I attended the previous meetings, we were discussing different things. Sometimes the questions contain answers. So the question is valuable as it is. It has some value in itself because it reveals itself partially. And it's really interesting for me to explore research or the study. For example, on the one hand, I hear some questions that have already answers in themselves, but there is also a lot of attention towards activity and towards work that I was doing some time ago. So this is a new perspective for me. It's a new point of view. It's like an inspection that you undertake. It's related to documentation, studying that documentation. So it's a different point of view for me. It's different from what I usually feel from the visitors who come to the gallery or from the other artists that helped us to organize the exhibitions. So it's this new perspective that I find here is very interesting for me. I can also share my experience about our street performances carried out by Leto group. So I stayed here in garage and we had a performance here in garage. It was called Interiorization 3. And it was very similar to the Leto practices. So we had our things outside, whereas here the performers were inside in the lobby of Garage Museum, and so they had their own method of walking through, they were singing, and the form of that performance was very open. Anyone could start walking around or sing, and there were some members of the staff that had the signs, this is the performance, please be careful. And then at some point I decided also to make some noises and walk around and become part of this performance. So while walking around the lobby, I could feel some attention from the guests and other people. But at some point, the curator from Garage came up to me and asked me to stop. So she referred to the fact that the artist felt very nervous, and that was her main argument, that I had to stop. But feeling nervous is a natural state for an artist, especially in the process of performance. So this is something I wanted to share with you. May I clarify? So you're speaking about our project, and you said that this project gives you a chance to take a retrospective view onto your project. So when you were working on the Leto Festival or ABC Gallery, did you face the same question? I have to think about it. Let me think about it. Good evening. I wanted to share my view with regards to independence. I'm not from Moscow, I'm from the region. So we're speaking about the market, about economic independence. This is irrelevant for regional initiatives because there's no market there. There is this spirit of heroes and romantic spirit because it's activists, outsiders that do something. They don't want to fit within the market structure. So they never really thought about selling their work seriously. It would be more important for them to find some support from the Ministry of Culture, from some museum institutions. They are trying to establish some contacts with different institutions, trying to sell themselves. So the most painful issue here is the issue of compromise. So being an activist, being a regional agent of changes, how can you fit in within this local context? Because there's a lot of crazy things. So every initiative has to look different, to pretend that it is something else. So instead of calling yourself contemporary art, you have to call yourself youth politics or patriotic education or some local history project. So you have to pretend that you are someone else. And of course, this is not honest, not sincere. Internally, you stick to the same spirit of enlightenment and art, but externally you have to pretend you're something else. So I used to be a deputy director of the State Museum, so I know this situation, this duality. And I know that lots of projects were funded as social initiatives and never as contemporary art. I think there's not much difference between Moscow and regions. And I can't say that there's a space for independent initiatives here in Moscow. Together with Maxim, we saw the time when there was Art Strelka, ABC Gallery, and ZHIR Gallery. So it was a space where you could land the premises. So you could rent the space and be very independent. We had Vladimir Dubasarsky, who coordinated all the interactions between ourselves and Red October Factory, and we never had any censorship. So it's a question of context and time period. We know that in the 1990s and in the year 2000s, there were lots of independent initiatives. Back in the 80s, there were lots of squats in Трехпрудный, Фурманный переулок. Lots of galleries that never rented any spaces. They never depended on anyone, and the authorities were not really interested in them. Especially in the 90s. But now this situation has changed. And together with ZHIR Gallery, we went through different stages of independence from different kinds of institutions. We started with a partnership project with a commercial gallery, so we relied on private capital a lot. Like Konstantin used to say, that they had their own vision as to what they wanted, and we had to pretend that we fit in with that vision. So, and as a result, we lost their support. Then we had a different partner with a private capital. Later on, we shifted towards a different kind of funding. So our donors never really dictated any policies. But I know that some different foundations do interfere in your work. They monitor every work of art at the exhibition. And if they position themselves as the organizers of the project, then again, there's lots of doubts whether you can get your independence. Then, apart from that, there are new legislation initiatives, so it's impossible to continue our work with partners. And now we reached a stage when this independence is just impossible. So I guess it was, you know, a long process, so there were different periods in it. So is this a recent issue? No, I can say that it started to be very relevant in the late 90s in the regions. We had the Soros Foundation in the late 90s. So actually this was the main source of funding because it funded many different things. And later on, we had to raise funds from other sources, like Michelson project with his gallery, or some other, you know, Ministry of Culture funds. But again, they were allocated for schools development rather than contemporary art. So we could use that money to publish the catalogs. But again, we had to call ourselves something else. We had to lie, you know. We could never call ourselves a contemporary art. I can add something about St. Petersburg. It depends on the context. It depends on the situation, where you get your space. Some space is rented. There might be some other agreements, for example, непокоренные, unconquerable. They give the work of art every year to the owners. Then some rent for their own money. Parasite works in the state exhibition center Paris. So they can exist in any other space in such a way. But speaking about content, these initiatives are independent because they do what they want. At one point, the ZHIR Gallery had a conflict with the Union of Artists because they had some disagreements with regard to payments. So basically, we still do what we want, and nobody controls us. If we speak about economic independence, I think it's a utopic discourse because Elektrozavod gallery does not fund anyone, so we can't really speak about economic independence. As to the grants and co-funding, it's also impossible. Because in order to attract the funds, you have to register as a non-commercial organization. But we refused from this kind of registration. So we could either have registered as a non-for-profit organization, but we decided not to, because we would lose our status as a self-organized organization, because we would have a different structure. So for us, independence is crucial to present the content we want to show. I never really bothered about independence. When I was a member of IB C group, ABC, I was thinking about structural equivalence of an organization. For example, it's one thing when the artist is invited by some organization, and it's another thing when the artist is part of his own organization. So it's not a proposal for an artist to join some project, it's a demand from one organization to another organization. So the other organization has to study this question, to explore it, and then give a response. So the curators that are involved are usually representatives of some organizations. Sometimes the curators set up their own initiatives, but it's a different story. So I would say it's not about independence, but the structural symmetry or structural response. And when I was thinking about Leto group performance and this comparison with the performance here in Garage, I wanted to focus on the interaction between the public institution and the artist. This is different all the time. For example, speaking about the Leto group, one of the people outside was making a performance, there were some passers-by, so there was the situation when everybody was equal. But of course it depends on the space where it takes place, whether it's an institution or some public space or just in the street. What I felt here in Garage was a different thing. So there was an institution, there is a public, there's an artist who had his own plan. And it's very interesting that it was the representative of the institution that comes up and explains how the public should behave. So you should behave in this way only. And it means there is a difference from self-organized practices, which are aimed at direct encounters with other people. Maybe there is this internal ethics that is important here, because you know there are some institutional rules in every museum. So for example, you can't make noise in a museum. That's why you feel this inertia. I also wanted to share my experience about some other performers that I have seen in art play, and the artists were moving, they were wearing same clothes as the public, but their behavior inside the performance was very different, because it was very difficult for the visitors to imitate that behavior. So that boundary was not due to the structure. Let's say there's a stage and then there's the space for viewers. It was based on the form of performance that the artists proposed. It's just like you can go to any concert with your own saxophone, start playing, but you'll see that there would be a lot of discord between your playing saxophone and the other musicians. I think you have touched upon very important issues. The external interaction between institutions and internal mechanisms of management. usually if we speak about organization, it's not just one person, apart from Kirill Preobrazhensky, who just gave his whole apartment for the artists. Usually there are several people that get together in order to start their self-organized initiative. What can you say about the relationships between those people? Can they be horizontal? Because there are several people and you can never reach full consensus. So how do you make decisions in this case? Is this a question for Kirill only? For everyone? Since you mentioned the word consensus, I can tell you something, yeah, because I have been to several training sessions on consensus. Our project has had a very long process of transformation. First we had the ZHIR Gallery that then changed into Media Udar Festival. So this was my first curatorial project. Then we realized that this was not exactly a right format. That's why we wanted to make it as horizontal as possible. I was a moderator for this project. Then there was a working group. So it was a very complex system of organization, had its own logic and rules. There are this process related to occupy and post-occupy. And it's very interesting to examine how this horizontal system works at different points in time. Like during the mobilization period, it works well, but later on, when it becomes more routine and continuous, it no longer works as great because there are different rules. That come on stage. Everybody is equal, but everybody is so different. They have different needs, different ambitions and requirements. So it becomes more and more difficult. So there's a science about consensus. But apart from theory, practice has an essential role because the team has a long way to develop, and so sometimes they have to discuss some details for a very long time and can be very painful process, and there's a threat of self-elimination, and we had a similar threat. Then if you overcome this stage, then people become to understand each other much better. They can feel each other, and so everybody fills up his own niche, so it becomes easier to work together and the work moves much faster. I agree with Tatiana. Every institution starts with hierarchy. Whenever you have this hierarchy or subordination, it means that there is some person that delegates the functions and some other people that carry out those functions. So there are different kinds of practices, and basically every institutional system has some structure of subordination, different responsibilities. So of course, if we speak about routine work, then it's true that these horizontal relationships would be a utopia, because it's clear who is the leader. Everybody knows what he or she is good at. So you're responsible for your own area. One person is good at IT, the other one is good at public relations. They can raise funds. The third person writes texts very well. So it then depends on the collaboration between these people and how far they're willing to go. So how can you make decisions? Either by voting, for example, in our gallery of one work of art, it was like that. and Maxim mentioned they had the right of veto, but the conflicts would be imminent because this community basically is existing due to those conflicts, but of course conflicts impede their work, and you can implement only like 9 out of 10 projects, so some artists or some institutions can be more bold than the other. It's also important to think about priorities. Of course, all the teams are about people, so it's all about human relationships. One wins, the other one loses. But it's important to understand that you working for the same cause, so you have this common cause, and maybe it's not about satisfying your own ambitions. Maybe you want to make something good for the city or for the art community or for the country even. So if you understand it well, then the initiatives will live much longer. If you don't have this common understanding, everything would break down. I agree with the previous speaker, and this distribution of responsibility and roles should be based on your own will or desire. One person is responsible for events, the other one for installation work, the third for photography. So when you distribute those roles, then your project will be very smooth. So it will be very good, otherwise you won't get good results. So it's very important to distribute those roles and responsibilities. It will help you to save a lot of time. I would like to ask a question to Natasha about your internal organization of Electroplant Gallery, because you were many people, now you're just 4 people, and you appeared more than a year ago, and there were many people at that time. I can think of several versions that can explain why it happened like that. When we just started developing our own alternative platform, we realized that it was not easy to find a common likely minded person, an artist that shares your point of view, who was willing to share your own experiences. So the financial factor was secondary. For us, it was more important to find a person that would be close to you, who understood what he wanted to reach, to achieve out of his art practices. Because like when people ask if they can join us, yes, you can. But you have to understand really well what you want to do and why you want to do it. It's true that at the beginning there were many people with us that organized different projects, who wanted to be curators or artists, but they had some biases. Some wanted to fit in with commercial gallery. Some considered the space of Elektrozavod as a startup for their future development. Some wanted to work for commercial gallery. So it depended on everyone, and everybody wanted something. So each person chose something which was right for them, something that they enjoyed. Because self-organization should be enjoyable for all. For example, if you want to go to a commercial gallery, it's your choice. So that's the reason why those people that used to be with us are no longer with us. It was their own choice, nothing else. I could aired that self-organized art initiatives are set up to share your experience, to learn something new, not just to showcase your own practices. That's what makes them valuable. Maybe it's more relevant for feminist projects. I think there is this attempt to overcome different hierarchies. Thinking about what kind of systems we function in, and how to go beyond those systems. Kirill, can you add something? I feel that we are focusing on technical details, like how to organize your production process, how to establish the hierarchy. We touch upon economic aspects or legal aspects. But this is not a new situation. As if there was a social underground that exists in parallel with official, institutions that can be both private or state-run. So I think the internal motivation is much more important than the principles of a self-organization, a community, or an attempt to fund it. I think there is a tradition common for at least some part of community to become and to stay within this underground, with this outsider's position. Like speaking about the 60s or 70s, I guess we have inherited the same Soviet tradition, like Moscow conceptual art, or non-conformists, the artists that had their own unique experience of self-organization, and that communal character was very important for Kabakov and others. We are living in a new economic environment, the internal politics of the country that changes from time to time. But there is the energy of internal resistance, which is demonstrated in different forms of self-organization. The forms that are possible at this time. For example, for me, the Cheremushki project was experimental. I wanted to make an upstart. I wanted to revive the movement that has existed since the 70s, and I wanted to call it as upstart. So if the context is changed, whether it's political context or economic context, then the country changes. And so how does it look like, how can you motivate them, how can you involve your friends? Well, we have discussed how you can manage this process, but I think it's very easy. Well, you know, you have friends, there are things that make you happy. So I can't say that this is the only resource that you have, but all those underground initiatives were based on man-to-man interaction, on human relations. So we can speak about different forms of self-organization, but it just depends on time and the energy which is moving it forward never changes. I guess Elena mentioned institutionalization of friendship. So this friendship becomes a new kind of institution because the likely-minded people not only are friends, but they have to work together. So you know, what can you do? For example, you know, there is this concept of being friends while resisting the system. And so how can you remain friends? I would like to respond to what Kirill has said. At first, I said that I feel as if the new was the point of view from the inspection. So it's an inspection point of view. There was experience that we had in 2000. When the response to all kinds of art exhibitions remained within that space where the exhibition took place or outside if it was a street performance. And the institution that chose show their interest in different initiatives seems to be long-term. I visited Dmitry Plavinsky exhibition in Pushkin Museum, and he observed plants, he contemplated the process of plants' growth, so this gave him some experience that he then expressed in his works of art. So this study of his was related to the result that he had, which was the work of art. So what happens when you accumulate some material, then you inspect it, and then what's the way out? I guess this is the main question of this study. What can this study lead to? So it's like with everything new. So we are living in a different conditions, you know, in capitalist society, and sometimes it's true that this society can inspect different communities, including art communities, in order to see what kind of strategies and tactics are used, because the capitalism is using this as a resource of what makes people do something. Because the motivation can be irrational very often. So by different forms of institutions, such as museums or other kinds of institutions, it becomes a subject for reflection. For example, Miziano made an exhibition about the impossible community. So it's based on self-reflection, and self-reflection is an attempt to carry out the internal inspection. And on the other hand, there are different institutions that explore the language of different communities. And I mean the languages in a very broad sense. Mm-hmm. I would like to argue with Kirill that discussing technical details replace the discussion of motivation. I can speak about my experience as part of Media Udar. So we got together, you know, be friends and likely-minded people. We were all inspired, we were all motivated by one common idea that everybody shared. At first I was a curator, then we decided to be equal, but then we realized that everybody perceived the situation differently. So it's very important to think how you can still be friends and not become enemies in the process of your work. Because sometimes when the colleagues become friends is a good thing, but sometimes friends stop to be colleagues. And this procedures related to self-organization, like assembly meetings and the methods to reach consensus, saved us from a large economic collapse. And for example, I experienced several personal crises that actually gave me a lot for my personal life. So that's why for me it's a very important concept that I would call horizontalization of conscience, because we are brought up within a system of hierarchy of some linear progress that we have to outperform somebody, to take over someone, we have to insist on our own opinion. This is a like a usual paradigm for person development in the Western world. And this image was something that we questioned. So we have made a very long way in understanding this, because in some situation, even when you feel that your opinion is right, maybe it's more important just to obey, you know, this project view, even though it fails, because this is very important for your internal things, because it's more beneficial for the project. So different methodologies to reach consensus really saved our project many times. I also worked on a global activism project, and we had a similar situation when different activists from different countries were brought together, and people just began to shout at each other at some point, but then they sort of exhaled, sat down by the at the table, and drew a structure to reach consensus, because it's all about overcoming models of behavior that you grow up with. And speaking about Kirill's experience, it was your apartment, so that's what that's was you were the boss. Well, I was making a magazine called Idiot, so I do understand what I say, but it really surprises me what you say. You speak about hierarchy, you speak that it's important, so you said that this is the Western model of success, the Western structure of hierarchy. Whenever we speak about self-organization, the economic activity doesn't make much sense, because there are some irrational elements that have to be taken into account. Well, we can call it different thing, Eastern versus Western. I think you have to be modest, to be humble. Maybe this is it comes from Eastern philosophy. And when I say humble, it means that this is the real nature of your curiosity when you are not closed onto yourself, but you can see somebody else. But I don't see any contradiction with what I said. Apart from being humble, there is also an ability to to be, you know, meek, you know, and otherwise you just go into different directions and stuck in your own corner, so nothing will come out of this. So you will argue and so it won't lead to anything. So being humble doesn't mean that you no longer do anything. You have to continue your work. It's just important to take account of some irrational laws. I think you are talking about different approaches to the initiatives. On the one hand, you can take a serious approach when you hope for a long-term work. And on the other hand, the second kind of approach is more like an intuitive approach, which is based on some super motivation. But it can't last forever. It's gonna be a very short period of time. Let me just finish my statement briefly. We understand that this is a positional work, a marginal kind of activity. But like Tanya Volkova said, it's important to be able to conclude a written agreement on the methodology of decision making. So it's like a self-made community based on the initiative coming from the bottom, but then they have to make this a capitalist kind of agreement. So they want to bureaucratize their protest spirit into some, you know, bureaucratic documents to approve some methods of decision making. And we're trying to oppose those things implicitly, and it leads us to a great paradox, because we are doing something else, whereas we're trying to get back to the traditional system, including the description and other things. I think you have to be passionate and to resist that formalized approach or economic procedures. Otherwise, it would look something else. But this passion can't last forever, because if you want to continue work on a long-term basis, you have to make the agreements, because at some point we realized that our ambitions were incompatible. So if we do not regulate the system of relationships, everything will collapse. And when we worked on media, Udar, we had a workshop on consensus, and so the first point that we had to learn was the group agreement, because it's crucial for any teamwork. Otherwise, you would have lots of mistakes. And so we had this group agreement. So we assume that it's available, even though it hasn't been finalized. So every person that becomes part of community has to understand that there is this community agreement, and they have to stick to those rules. But what about the group коллективные действия, collective actions? Did they have anything? Oh, they had a lot of things. They had a table, they had different structures. I think nobody is obliged to do anything. So not everybody is ready for compromise. It's all up to you. Some person is willing to reach consensus, some won't, no matter whether you motivate them or not. And for example, even though despite any paper, you cannot change that. I think it doesn't really matter what kind of methods you choose. The most important thing is the content that appears as a result, and that's all about individual choice. If you don't want to be to look like bureaucrats, you can do it, but the final result is the most important thing. But I would like to get back to the concept of self-organization. What does it mean, this term? For example, the garage museum is also a self-organization. So what is implied that there are certain initiatives that turn into collective projects. The only difference that I can see here is the difference between personal and collective projects. And everything else is just self-organization. If you work on a collective or team project, of course, there's more and more motivation, it requires more work on yourself. And I can tell you, as the editor, one more question that we have to discuss is related to the model of external interaction. And this external interaction includes working with different institutions. For example, we had long talks with Elektrozavod Gallery related to whether they wanted to participate in this project or not. Ilya Orlov, for example, refused to participate in our project. So, on one hand, self-organized initiatives oppose the institutions, but it's difficult to stick to the strategy of resistance. I think it's wrong to stick to this counter strategy, and you know, it's impossible to work within this model of resistance. Institutions often absorb those independent initiatives, just trying to get engaged, to engage them into their work. For example, Екатерина Дёготь, who was a participant of a similar discussion, introduced the term institutional activism, when activists come to the institutions and begin to do something with an anti-institutional message. So, what do you think about it? Is it possible to interact with institutions? Can you be partners with institutions instead of being competitors? I think you have answered all your questions. I think you should make this children question different. What's wrong with institution? What is it that you don't like about institutions? Usually what we say that there's a lot of inertia and bureaucracy in any institution, because that's the main reason why people don't like museums. Lots of bureaucracy, lots of things that you can't do, lots of prohibitions. So if we speak about institutions of a new type, all those institutions position themselves as a new kind of institution, but it doesn't mean that they stick to different rules. They have the same subordination system as in traditional institutions. So, of course, it doesn't make sense to fight against the institution. It's more productive to propose a different scenario. I would like to give an example of Wolfgang Tillmans that that organized the rave party in Hermitage. So different people came to this institution and filled it with different effects that nobody accustomed to seeing that thing. So it means infiltrating this institution with a different kind of feelings, and as a result this institution becomes to expand, but it expands not as by itself, but through people that go there, different kind of people that come there and makes it special. And Garage is one of similar institutions. I don't know if there are many museums that are ready to do this, because it's not easy to organize performances in traditional museums, but it depends on the staff members. For example, in Samara Museum, we have been working with such initiatives. So, some company or friends come to the museum, they can change the perception of this institution. But can this rave of Tillmans change the ideology of the institution? Of course, if they invited him, it means they wanted to turn into a different direction, to absorb some alternative kind of experience. So Hermitage was very open. It's a fiction. It was not the Hermitage initiative to have that rave. It was the first and the last rave party in the Hermitage. If only it were not the last rave party. I wish it were not the last party. Well, we came here and we, describe our great initiatives. But this is an example of merging, merging and acquisition, because this discussion should take place in a different space, not in Garage, because that's how big financial institutions, how big corporations absorb smaller things. Of course, can say that if we didn't have such institutions, we wouldn't have had self-organized initiatives, because they appear as a personal story for an artist, because it gives him a chance to be autonomous, whereas the institution sets up their own rules and they plan for a long period of time. They say today, this period of time, we're going to have the exhibition of Louise Bourgeois, then later we're going to have that, etc. I think that when we speak about institutions, the most important thing are people that work there. And we've innovated for, we were nominated for an innovation award a couple of times. And most of the people that work for our festival are against museification, archivation, etc. So, beginning with the early 20th century, avant-garde never wanted to make its way to the museums. That was their main reason, the main purpose. And for me, the people that work in different institutions are the most important thing, because, for example, it was only because Sasha Obuhova that I came here. It was Sasha who invited me here, so that's why I came. I started working with Sasha Obuhova at the Tretyakov Gallery. We worked on the archive together. So, it's very important for me to reflect on the project, to document the project, to keep all this information in the archive. If we don't do it, then other critics from different countries would do it instead of us, and then we would have to, you know, provide critical information as to how it was really in real life. So it all depends on people, because sometimes the information is extorted, and it's not very nice. Since you mentioned archives, was it important for you to document your activities? For example, little group festivals were available for small groups of people, but due to the documentation that they kept, we can look at that initiative, at least partially. It depends on every organization, because it's up to you. You try to document, of course. But for me, museification is not that important. Well, some people are really interested in you know, making archive and then showing this information, and they make you try to remember some things, and it's sometimes interesting to think what we had and what we didn't have. I guess the community works very fast as compared to the museum, so it's easy to show, to broadcast this information easily. So if you use a right approach, you'll you get a very wide audience, much wider than a museum has. So, speaking about broadcasting, because documentation is part of broadcasting. It's related to the specific type of activity that self-organized structures have. Because for the festivals, it's important to inform the society about its work. But there are more closed communities sometimes. And they don't want to be known. So, because there is this resistance towards media coverage. I think it's good that we came to Garage. So it's very interesting to take a closer look into different curators or artist initiatives that are based on the grassroots level. So, speaking about the declaration of intent, it sometimes is not on the political level, but on a different level, on a social level. For example, we are in the Museum of Contemporary Art, and it's good to feel this aesthetic component. Actually, based on this kind of research, I came up with a new series of works. So this was the main reason for me to participate here. I also wanted to add something with regards to interaction between art initiatives and institutions. We find ourselves in a very special situation, in a unique situation when we have to be friendly with each other, because we have to maintain a friendly dialogue, because contemporary art is often marginalized. There's lots of pressure on art institutions from the state and from the society. So using the language of contemporary art creates a challenge to self-organized art initiatives. And so, of course, self-organized art initiatives and other art institutions can change the attitude, can change the situation in political, ideological way. We were talking to Stjopa Volodin, and I wanted to, and he represented Krasnodar Gallery of Contemporary Art and Yama Gallery. So he said that they didn't want to use any state money, any government money. Otherwise, because if they had to use that money, it would mean that the Cossacks would come to inspect them. And so, for example, example, sometimes Cossacks wanted to destroy contemporary art. But, you know, it's a special city. You can't do much without the participation of Cossacks. They mentioned that fortunately their city had lots of wealthy people and they were very understanding. Sometimes artists want to fund some of their projects and they think that the institutions that they interact with should be loyal to different art statements. But it turns out that within this progressive institution, what we see is a lot of restrictions. The simple gestures may not be exhibited, may not be shown due to some reasons. And there are lots of questions why these institutions censor the works that we want to showcase. And then it becomes clear that this institution is functioning within some strict legal frameworks, and you can't really do much about it. So, and I know how many restrictions there if we speak about contemporary art, and I don't know how we can change the situation. I know that the city often become the main site for the artists. Of course, you become more vulnerable to the police, to the passers-by, but hopefully without Cossacks. It's true that the place is very important. So the location was crucial for us because this was the principle that we used in order to split our discussions into different sections. For example, private spaces, other places, no man's land, which was like the natural environment, borderline territory. So how do you choose the space for your initiatives? Why do many people choose the space of factories or plants, for example, Artstrelka? I don't know whether the people could understand that it would be so successful or not, or Electroplant Gallery. Because this space can go through gentrification process, so there won't be any space for studios. It would be used only for offices or the ZHIR Gallery. So why plants and factories? I would like to suggest adjusting this question. It's not what we choose, but what are the options for us to choose from? Because this choice is quite limited. There is either one way or another, and no other options are available. So if there is a proposal to make an exhibition and open the gallery in Strelka, then you just go with it. Then there is this, for example, the proposal from Garage. You can either participate in it or not. It's not that I planned several years ago that I wanted to participate in this conference in Garage, so now I carry this plan forward. Well, your classification probably exhausted the list of spaces, private place, city space. But in the past, the city was perceived as no one's land, so you can go there and use it. Whereas now, the city becomes a very important symbolic background. But are we talking about it as organizers who are thinking, oh, what kind of place can we use for our project? Or are we talking about it as artists? I feel myself an artist right now. So as an artist, I just plan my project, and so I'm thinking whether I want to do it outside or inside. So once I get down to the practical implementation of my project, I will think about the background, what would be the key element of my art. It's true that when you make your choice, you just consider the options available. For example, if we speak about workshops and studios, you look for a right place that has to meet some criteria. For example, the price that you have to pay if you want to rent a place. Then nobody is guided by the principle how long it is going to run for. No one is thinking about some business projects that can be carried out in a certain place. And for example, in the Nedar gallery, there are many different people, but it is they're going to have some social infrastructure elements, some business center later. But those people that rent their spaces from the Nedar center, then they don't even know about it. Sometimes you just need a place for some time, and you don't really care about the rules that Elektrozavod has, for example. So you stay there for a couple of months, and that's fine. It's already good. So I don't really know if we can speak about some, time horizon, the planning and the strategy. Maybe Natasha could clarify their view of the gallery. How can you think about the future if your role is limited by some factors? I would like to add something. It's true that there are these limitations, not only related to time, but some rules that you have to follow. For example, the owner that has some requirements than the entrance rules, for example. And it's not true only about Elektrozavod, but also about Niedar. Well, as to gentrification, it won't be possible because we have very strict entrance regime. The security guards are always checking and monitoring the situation. So there are very strict rules that everybody has to follow. Not long ago, I had a meeting with the top management, and I found out that Elektrozavod was part of the cultural development, and so it was to be part of art cluster, a cluster with different studios and workshops. So they wanted me to eliminate the link to our place. So I can feel that, you know, for example, you can't do any filming in the space. So there's a very strict system of control. I don't know how we keep going there, but gentrification is out of the question anyway. I would also like to point out to the legislation of the Russian Federation, which is also an important thing to consider. For example, you know, propaganda of homosexualism to children, propaganda of drugs, it makes a big blow onto the legal persons. For example, physical persons have to pay a penalty of 6,000 rubles, and legal entities have to pay 1 million rubles for the propaganda of homosexualism to children. So those places that let us use their premises, like Vinzavod and others, they have a big threat, because if the inspectors come to the place, they come to the owner, so they will be legally responsible, and it's a serious matter. So I don't think we are going to have a place here in Moscow, because nobody will want to work with us. So we used to work for free, and Artplay did all the PR campaign for us. So I guess it would be better just to rent some place. But if you want to rent a place, then you'll have to pay a fee. And this has some other factors that restrict our activities. So it's not about free choice of sites. We just always think about what we can do and how we can do it with the minimum harm for all. I just wanted to add something with regards to the censorship at Elektrozavod. When you organize an event, make all the lists of people that may be allowed for the exhibition. So the security guards come to your exhibition for inspection. They take pictures of every work of art, and then you know, they would say, "Oh, I just like the work, but because I just wanted to publish it on my social network account." I think the security guards take pictures of the most weird works, and, as they think, because I think it's part of the censorship process, because I guess all the works are censored. The choice is made not through the list of rules. It's not that the person, you know, reads this list of rules and then does something. At first, they just do something, and then they think what they can do if there's something wrong. And the question is how long people can use these the chances that they have. Speaking about former industrial plants that didn't start the process of modernization or reconstruction, the developers give it for art initiatives. This doesn't happen spontaneously, because the participants know when they can start doing some things. For example, Emma space in Chistyi Prudy and Yauza. Was to be available up to November this year, and everybody knew this. This is something we discussed in August at the Do-It-Yourself Festival. So nobody was panicking about it. So everybody understood that we could use those premises for a certain period of time, even though some attempts failed, but anyway, it happened. And it's a good experience. It was a good experience of collaboration between the people that owned the space and provided that space for different cultural initiatives that can be used by other people that can invent something. We have run out of time, in fact, so thank you very much. And we will see you in half an hour and continue this talk. And we'll have different panels. Thank you.